Authorities investigating the cyanide contamination of Tylenol have narrowed their suspects to four. The FBI arrests a man who allegedly threatened to use cyanide to kill suburban hospital patients.
Suburban police probe the murder of an elderly Cicero man. State banking authorities reassure depositors in the wake of the state's fifth bank failure this year.
And we'll have details coming up on the 9 o'clock news.
We hope you've enjoyed tonight's WGN Saturday Night Movie. We hope you can join us for Tuesday, 7 p.m. feature, Master Gunfighter, starring Tom Loughran. Tonight's feature was brought to you in part by Heilemann's Old Style, fully croissant, double brewed, the old world way. The Chicago Public Library is sponsoring a special series of programs about Chicago authors on October 14th. For more information, call 269-2891.
This season, Maple Furriers brings you something special.
The way I see it, fur makes any occasion something special.
At Maple Furriers, it's our manufacturing that makes the difference. Fur fashions that are something special. Maple Furriers on the Oak Park Mall. Also, Maple at Hanmore, 300 North Michigan Avenue.
Fur makes any occasion something special.
If you don't know furs, know your furrier. And we want to be your furrier.
It didn't just happen by chance. The five-door links from Mercury. The substance shows.
Lincoln now offers this newest carpeting in the industry. Have that decorator look without a decorator's price. Buy three rooms full for only $249. Pay less than $20 a month. Nine rich earth tones plus red hot red, wild plum, silver gray, and more. Three rooms full, $249, with immediate free delivery.
When you're thinking Lincoln, Lincoln, better carpeting, well, let's call National 29000. National 29000.
The 9 o'clock news with Robert Jordan, Marty McNeely, and the WGN News team.
Good evening. The list of suspects narrows in the Tylenol cyanide murder mystery as investigators rule out more leads in the case. Today, investigators looked into another out-of-state cyanide death, that of 19-year-old Jay Mitchell, who died July 26th in Sheridan, Wyoming. However, as of tonight, no firm link has been established between that and the seven Chicago-area Tylenol cyanide deaths. But other progress is reported. During an afternoon news briefing, Illinois Attorney General Tyrone Fahner said that the list of eight or nine suspects has been narrowed.
We have four people that are still actively being worked. We've put a lot of time into that four, but I think we all realize the problem of dealing with numbers, because beside that four, we have other active leads that we've classified or prioritized to give our efforts to. But of that original number, we are still, in fact, working on four. The rest have washed out.
Fahner also commented on some sharp criticism for Cook County Medical Examiner Robert Stein, who earlier today said he completed tests which indicated the poisoned capsules could have come from the manufacturing or distribution plants. Fahner disagrees.
The manufacturer would have had to have been, there would have been uniformity in the capsules, perhaps, was part of the manufacturing process. But just assume they were salted there. There's no way in the world, with the hundreds of thousands of bottles that come from Pennsylvania, that if they were to start there or anywhere in a distribution chain, come to Illinois first, that they would come on this geographical area. They would have indeed ended up in other states or in other parts of this state. Instead, it's been salted in a specified area, which you're well aware of. Those are the reasons why the FBI and I personally believe that it's the way that we've suggested, and not from the factory.
Fahner also commented on another aspect of the case, an extortion letter written to the Tylenol manufacturers. The North Suburban businessman whose name was signed to the letter was apparently the victim of a hoax. But Fahner says there will be criminal prosecution of the real author of the letter, who is still being traced. Extortion charges will be filed against 20-year-old James Howard of Chicago. The FBI says Howard threatened to use cyanide to kill patients at Gottlieb Memorial Hospital in Melrose Park. He allegedly demanded $8,000. Howard was arrested today. He is not believed to be connected to the 7 cyanide deaths. Marty?
Authorities in the northern Illinois county of DeKalb are searching for the person who wrote a letter claiming to have put cyanide in a gallon of apple cider. DeKalb County Sheriff Wilbur Scott says he thinks the letter, sent to a DeKalb newspaper, is a vicious prank. But authorities are warning residents not to drink apple cider bought at the Johnson Orchard. There have been no reports of any poisonings, and analysis of some of the cider from the orchard have shown no contamination. DeKalb County is about 25 miles west of Winfield, the site of one of the 7 poisoning deaths caused by cyanide-tainted extra-strength Tylenol capsules. Also, a 41-year-old man is recovering tonight after being rescued from the rough waters of Lake Michigan at Fullerton Rocks. Police say Max Bressett decided to go for a swim this afternoon and discovered the waters were much rougher than they appeared. A companion on shore called for help and the Belmont Harbor rescue boat was dispatched. Bressett was taken by fire department ambulance to St. Joseph Hospital. Hospital officials say he refused treatment and left the building. Robert?
And still to come on the 9 o'clock news, a suburban Chicago bank becomes the state's 5th bank to close this year. And President Reagan blasts Poland's leadership.
When the hotels that welcome the American Express card get ready for you, they know what you expect. They know how to prepare for you, comfort you, excite you, and care for you, because they know you. You're an American Express card member. They know what you expect.
Mr. Barry, we've been waiting for you.
Take the card to Americana Hotels. They know what you expect.
Raise your hand.
You got it.
Raise your hand.
You know it. You feel confident, secure.
Raise your hand.
You feel dry now.
Raise your hand.
You know why now.
Raise your hand.
You've got it. That sure, secure, confident feeling. Because each sure gives you enough protection to help feel dry all day.
Confident, confident, dry and secure. Raise your hand if you're sure.
Hello, I'm Paul Finnemore, president of Hairline Creations. For years, we've helped men of all ages from all walks of life who are concerned about their appearance. If you are balding, replace your hair with the most natural and secure hair replacement available without the fear of that unnatural look. Our patented product truly feels and behaves like your own hair, maybe better. Swim, sleep, and socialize worry-free. Call Hairline Creations at 282-5454 and end your baldness.
Federal and state banking authorities tonight are advising depositors in Illinois not to be concerned or alarmed because authorities have ordered closed the Tri-State Bank of Markham. Authorities say the state's system of commercial banking is strong and safe. The South Suburban Bank was found to be unsafe and unsound and have unsafe banking practices which resulted in excessive loans and operating losses. Depositors of the bank will receive checks next week.
The FDIC has made arrangements to begin issuing checks to the depositors Tuesday morning, October 12th at 9 a.m.
Arrangements have been made to locate a temporary limited service facility for Tri-State's 7,000 depositors. The facility will be operated by Interstate Bank of Oak Forest. With unemployment in Illinois at a 30-year high, it was not surprising that there was a big turnout today at General Foods Kool-Aid plant on Chicago's South Side. The firm had advertised 250 temporary jobs. Some 4,000 people showed up to apply. The company will begin hiring the few lucky ones in about 3 weeks.
Berwyn police tonight are investigating the death of a 67-year-old Cicero man. The man's body was found in his Berwyn restaurant. Don Harris has a report.
Leo Manfredi's body was found in the basement of his restaurant at 6233 Roosevelt Road. There was a large gash in his head, and since there is not enough room to stand up in the basement, there was a theory he might have cracked his head on a beam. Now the medical examiner's office says he was shot. One of the last persons to see him alive was the owner of the barbershop next door.
So some of his friends came over Thursday and couldn't find him?
Yeah.
Right. I came looking for you. No, they didn't come looking for me. They just asked me, you know, have you seen Leo? And I said, yeah, he's in the store as far as I know. You know, his car's outside. That was it.
They didn't get in?
No, the door was locked.
No. And his daughter came?
No, his daughter came the following morning and asked me if I had seen Leo. And just like I just told you, I had seen him in the morning. Other than that, you know, that was the last time I saw him. So she decided to call the police to get in there, you know, just in case something was wrong.
There was no sign of forced entry. The restaurant had been closed for 3 months. For WGN News, this is Don Harris.
A drug raid on a Southside apartment building today netted Chicago police 15 suspects and a half pound of heroin valued at $1 million. Police say one of the suspects, 65-year-old Chuck Ashley, is one of the most efficient, their words, drug dealers on the Southside. The raid took place at a building Ashley owns at Maryland Avenue and East 65th Street. Police say they're looking for six suspects.
Well, Northwestern has proven it wasn't a fluke. Bill Berg will have that, plus baseball playoff highlights and more. And I'll have a report on a very unusual auction after a break.
This week on Laugh Tracks, our guests will be David Soul,
all right.
You know, I'm really a nice, easygoing guy. Like you, I enjoy a little peace and quiet. But sometimes it doesn't work out that way. So it's good I've got my Captain Black. It's always cool smoking. It never bites me. And you never have to inhale. So if you're not getting all the peace and quiet you want, hey, relax and enjoy a pipe full of Captain Black. Never a bite in a bowl.
Rattle, rattle, thunder, clatter, boom, boom, boom.
Don't worry, call the Car-X man.
One thing you don't have to worry about at a Car-X muffler shop is the price. People call to see how much it costs and what they get for their money. And you'd be amazed how many of those callers become our customers. Of course, it could be my pleasant telephone voice.
Rattle, rattle, thunder, clatter, boom, boom, boom.
Don't worry, call the Car-X man.
A colorful and unusual spectacle is being held in Chicago this weekend. Hundreds of exotic birds and reptiles will be going on the auction block, giving bird and reptile lovers a chance to purchase the rare animals for as much as one-third to one-half below retail price. Today, there was a rare preview.
The direct auctioneer showroom was full of the sounds of a tropical rainforest. Caws, tweets, and whistles from brilliant and exotic birds. The bird and reptile auction is scheduled for Sunday, but viewing by interested customers was held on Saturday.
I have approximately 13, 14, 15 birds. I'm not sure about the count. I wanted to see if they had red macaws, blue macaws, and the African grays, and possibly might buy one.
Do you see something you like?
I like them all.
We lost our bird recently, and I'd like to get a bigger one, like a cockatoo, but I don't know.
What happened to your other bird?
It flew out the window. I left the door open and it flew out. So, trying to get another one. And they're easy to take care of, too.
There are over 1,000 animals for sale at the auction, the most expensive being the birds. The cages are filled with macaws, Amazon parrots, cockatoos, cockatiels, finches, and more, plus an assortment of snakes and lizards.
We've got a pretty big variety here tomorrow. We've got a price range on some of the reptiles of $2, going on up to $3,000 or $4,000 a piece for some of the birds, such as this hyacinth macaw here.
Are they rare?
This particular bird is, yes. There's probably no more than a few hundred of them in this country at the present time.
According to Jacobson, birds are the third leading animal sold by pet stores, right behind dogs and cats, and they're said to be increasing in popularity. And there's another consideration. The larger parrots have an equivalent lifespan of human beings, so a goodbye here could mean a friend for life.
And many of those attending the showing are serious bird fanciers, some with large collections.
I would say right now, give or take with the lovebird babies that we have, between 65 and 70 birds.
How do you take care of so many?
Oh, it's a good four-hour job every morning. By the time you change cages, clean cages, and wash dishes, and give them fresh seed and fruit, and it's a lot of work, but it's a lot of fun. You get a lot of enjoyment out of it.
And there were young animal lovers at the showing. Five-year-old Joey Jacobson is a reptile fancier, and he's liked snakes for about 2 years.
Do your friends know that you aren't afraid of snakes?
No.
Yeah? What about when the kids come over to your house to play? Are they afraid of your pet snakes?
They don't come to my house.
You want to do the show like that?
Oh, that's a lot of fun, yeah.
That's why they don't come over.
I have my own birds, yeah, the Cardinals. They are losing right now. They are losing, Marty. But the game is underway in St. Louis. The weather in St. Louis is just fine tonight. The Cardinals and Braves are underway in game two of that playoff series. In the seventh inning, the Braves are leading 3-2. St. Louis jumped out to a 1-0 lead in the first inning as Braves pitcher Phil Niekro uncorks a wild pitch on one of those dancing knucklers. It scores Kenny Obergefell from third. The Braves took the lead off John Stuper in the third. Rafael Ramirez drives a base hit to center right here. That'll score Bruce Benedict. But when Willie McGee overruns the ball in center, Ramirez has a chance to circle the bases on a three-base error. He does just that with his great speed, and it gives the Braves a 2-1 lead. There he is. Right now, like I said, the Braves lead it 3-2 in the seventh inning. Meanwhile, in the American League playoffs, the Milwaukee Brewers won their second straight game over California and will now face the Angels tomorrow afternoon to decide who will represent the American League in this year's World Series. Now, watch this. The Brewers scored three runs on one play in the second inning. Two men on base, Mark Brujard lines a base hit to center. Ted Simmons scores, but center fielder Freddie Lynn overthrows Doug DeSense at third. That permits Don Money to come up the line and score. And when DeSense throws wildly to home, nowhere near catcher Bob Boone, the umpire waves Brujard all the way around the bases. He comes home to make it 3-0 Brewers. Three runs on one play. Really incredible. Not the kind of thing you generally see in playoff competition. Angel starter Tommy John just didn't have it today. Three wild pitches. That's a playoff record. You'll see one right here into the dirt. It scores Money in the fourth to make it 4-0. The Angels made it close, though. Don Baylor's going to get his pitch. Watch it, a hanging breaking ball right over the middle of the plate, and crunch. Off to left field it goes. 392 feet away, a grand slammer off starter Moose Haas to make it 7-5 Milwaukee, but that's as close as California could get. The Brewers went on to get the victory 9-5. Game 5, like I said, tomorrow afternoon in Milwaukee. Turning to football, a big shocker in Evanston, where the Northwestern Wildcats knocked off conference rival Minnesota 31-21. The victory marked Northwestern's first conference win since 1977 and raised their season mark to 2 wins and 4 losses. It was all Minnesota early. The Golden Gophers raised their lead to 21-3. Second quarter, quarterback sneak Mike Cohensey from 1 yard out. But Northwestern then capped a drive. Sandy Schwab, you'll see him. He's going to roll out right off play action. He'll hit John Harvey in the end zone. 6 yard scoring strike. NU trails 21-10. But the biggest play of the ball game right here, third quarter. Ricky Edwards, look at the block he gets. That gets him outside. Nobody's going to contain him. 30 yards down the side. He will score for the Wildcats. They played tough D the rest of the way and went on to win that ball game 31-21. There's Northwestern score on top. Further downstate in Champaign, the Fighting Illini raised their record to 5 wins, 1 loss as they pounded out a 38-34 victory over Purdue. And Dan Rohn has this report from Memorial Stadium.
Illinois fumble set Purdue up in the third quarter. A 5-play drive ending on Benson's fine catch in the end zone. 27-24 Purdue after 3. Eason got Illinois back in front just a minute into the period when Oliver Williams grabbed the touchdown pass. 31-27 after the kick, but far too early to celebrate. Another Illini mistake, a pass interference play on third down put the Boilers at the 1 from where Carter picked up his second touchdown of the day. 34-31 Purdue. That put it back on Eason's shoulders, and he struck in a hurry, looking up the left sideline for running back Mitchell Brookins, whose momentum carried him into the end zone and carried Illinois to a 38-34 advantage. The Illini defense stopped Campbell on downs one time, but he got a final shot at it with 2 seconds to play. Out of the shotgun, the pass was caught all right, but it was caught well out of the end zone. It was then and only then that you heard a collective sigh of relief at the end of one wild football game. So Illinois hangs on to win it 38-34. The Illini move to 4-0 in the Big Ten, 5-1 overall, and they face Ohio State next week right here in Champaign. At Memorial Stadium, this is Dan Rome.
And you think Earl Bruce's Buckeyes aren't going to be nasty? I'll tell you about it in a moment. Elsewhere in the Big Ten, Michigan beat interstate rival Michigan State. And get this, for the first time since 1918, yes, Wisconsin won at Columbus. That makes three straight losses at home for the Buckeyes, who will go against the Illini next week. Iowa downed Indiana in a close ball game at Bloomington. Elsewhere in college football, Southern Illinois is losing to Florida State. Eastern Illinois shut out Akron 18-0. And the Fighting Irish got a field goal with 11 seconds to play to beat the Hurricanes of Miami of Florida. The game was scoreless when quarterback Blair Keel sprints 7 yards. Look at him going for the corner right here, going to dive into the end zone. 7-0 with 2:25 left in the first half, much to the delight of Notre Dame coach Jerry Faust. Miami quarterback Mark Richt drives the Hurricane 74 yards, hitting Glenn Dennison, 1 yard touchdown pass, tie ball game. After an Irish field goal, Miami took the lead, 14-10. Richt going up top, hits speedster Rocky Belk, 79-yard strike, 13-03. The cornerback got turned around on that one, but the Irish were not to be denied, down 14-13. Mike Johnson steps back, 33-yard try, it's in the air, right through the middle. Irish win it with 11 seconds to go, 16-14. In the top 10, number 1 ranked Washington bombed California, number 2 Pittsburgh was idle. And in an exciting game down in Birmingham, Alabama, the 4th ranked Crimson Tide defeated number 3 Penn State 42-21. Penn State trailed 7-0 early in the game when Kurt Warner gets free in the Alabama secondary for quarterback Todd Blackledge. The play covers 69 yards and the Lions tie it at 7. The Crimson Tide then drove 72 yards with quarterback Walter Lewis throwing 6 yards right here to Joe Carter for the go-ahead touchdown. It's 14-7 Bama. It was 24-14 Alabama in the fourth quarter when Blackledge throws 13 yards to Kevin Baugh to make it 24-21. But that was as close as Penn State would get today. Blackledge was intercepted. Penn State 30-yard line. Eddie Lowe picks it off. He breaks a couple of tackles. He's headed for the end zone. An exciting win for Bear Bryant's Crimson Tide. Final score, Bama 42, Penn State 21. Checking the rest of the top 10 scores. Number 5, Georgia rolled over Mississippi. Number 6, SMU trails Baylor in the third quarter. And 7th-ranked Nebraska had little trouble with Colorado. 8th-ranked UCLA was tied by a tough Arizona ball club. Number 9, Arkansas held Texas Tech to only 3 points. And 10th-ranked North Carolina breezed past Wake Forest. Well, the Blackhawks are in Montreal tonight taking on the Canadiens. And right now we're happy to say the Hawks lead it 5-2 in the second period. The Hawks started the scoring in the first period. Dennis Savard coming up here, misses a long slap shot, but Doug Wilson's there to put in the rebound. Rick Patterson extended the Hawks' lead to 2-0 when he takes a breakaway pass and scores with a backhand shot. Once again, the Hawks are winning 5-2 that game in the second period. In horse racing, Lemhi Gold captured the $565,000 Jockey Club Gold Cup at Belmont Park today in a race that was marred by a multiple horse accident along the backstretch. Marshall Cassidy has the call.
Island World has dropped back into second, but Christmas Past has overtaken Island World. Christmas Past is behind Lemhi Gold. On the far outside is Silver Supreme. It's Lemhi Gold leading the way by about 4 lengths. And now Silver Supreme moves alongside Christmas Past. They race to the wire with Lemhi Gold in front. Lemhi Gold, Chris McCarron aboard, wins by 3.5. Silver Supreme was second. Christmas Past was third.
Two horses, the pre-race favorite, Timely Rider and Johnny Dance, had to be destroyed due to their injuries. Both horses had suffered broken legs. A very, very sad happening indeed. And Marty, it was an exciting day in sports. The Spoilermakers almost lived up to that nickname. Gave Illinois a tough ball game. The Irish, last second, what else is new? A field goal victory. And how about Northwestern?
Northwestern, the Wildcats, they aren't going to push them around anymore.
No, I'm very happy for Dennis Green and his ball club.
Me too.
Okay, Robert?
Yeah, it's good. In a moment, Tom Skilling with a somewhat brighter forecast for the rest of the weekend.
Be fond of Honda's front-wheel drive handling. It makes Chicago traffic a breeze.
I'm fond of Honda.
And you'll be fond of Honda's styling and dependability, backed by a network of quality dealers.
We make it simple at your Chicagoland Honda dealer.
We make it simple to own a new Honda. With great trade-ins and affordable prices, all of Chicago is saying, I'm fond of Honda.
Honda.
Chicagoland in Northwest Indiana.
We make it simple.
Today is my 55th birthday. Got this sweater from my wife. Got this tie from my neighbor, Carl. I even got something from Allstate Insurance.
Allstate update. 55 and retired discounts.
If you're 55 and retired, Allstate thinks you're a better risk. So they gave me a 10% discount on home insurance and another discount on auto insurance. Discounts are a good thing. Hope Carl got one on this tie.
Allstate's 55 and retired discounts. Another reason you're in good hands with Allstate.
True Link Fence for beauty, privacy, security. 100 styles of fences and playground equipment. Their 30th anniversary sale. Dial True Link, T-R-U-L-I-N-K.
What's happening?
You're wasting away to nothing. I'm jealous.
You know, Tom, I was going to go out and try to rake the leaves, but they're all wet and everything else. We've had a lot of rain.
Yes, but tomorrow we'll dry out some. We've changed our forecast, Bob. We have a big dry tongue on the way, and it means a lot of sunshine, lower humidities, and very pleasant temperatures tomorrow. But your leaves are wet, and so are many others around the area tonight, Bob, because we had heavy rain last night, particularly if you were north and west of Chicago. Here's a plot of rainfall totals from our WGN and our National Weather Service observers, and the amounts range from about 11 hundredths of an inch down toward the Calumet City area to about 24 hundredths of an inch in the Loop. Wheaton had a half an inch, over a half an inch, close to two-thirds of an inch up here in Streamwood, and about 35 hundredths at Wilmette. By the time you moved up, though, to McHenry, 1.54 inches of rain, close to 2 inches up by Harvard and Lake Villa. Joe Bysick, our observer there, reported over 1 inch of rain. The reason for all the precipitation and the inclement weather through the central part of the country is a big and very slow-moving storm. Now, this storm is sending a cool front with some drier air coming our way in our direction, but moist air continues out to the east with a huge shield of rain. And look at the big area of snow, which has dropped 22 inches out in the Black Hills with 60-mile-an-hour winds. You can imagine what travels like there. Breckenridge in Colorado reported 12 inches of snow. No snow for us, but the cooler air on its backside will be here early next week. We think tonight that we're out of most of the rain after a band of thunderstorms now moving through Chicago goes through. These showers are scattered from southeast Wisconsin down into Indiana, but most of your rain, including the heavy stuff, is up here in northern Wisconsin, Minnesota, and the blizzard rages out in the Black Hills yet tonight. So most of it's by us, and our temperatures coming in are beginning to cool off some. The 80s reached up into central Illinois around Champaign today. Chicago hit 65, but there are only 30s and 40s out to the west, and it's this cooler air that is sweeping up our way. Tomorrow, upper 60s. By Monday, for Columbus Day, probably only 50s around this area. The satellite shows the clearing that's coming our way. Big storms like this form in comma shapes, and you see this intrusion of dry air that we call a dry tongue. It's this area that has cleared the skies out in the western part of the state, and we think this is the sunshine that will be in tomorrow before this cloud mass comes back in, not tomorrow, but tomorrow night and Monday, with some rain coming down, perhaps for the parade. We're hoping we can change that by Monday. Radar tonight shows a line of thunderstorms from Kenosha and Racine down through Chicago into northwest Indiana. Once these are out of here, the screen is clean out to the west, and our forecast for tomorrow shows the storm continuing to move very slowly through the Midwest. Windy, chilly air will wait another day to come in. Tomorrow we'll settle for lots of sunshine, low humidities, pleasant temperatures, and keep the snow up here in Minnesota, northern Minnesota at that. And temperatures tomorrow in the 60s here in Chicago, but see the cooler air out here to the west? This is the air that will come in by early next week, and we'll keep our neighbors in the southeast very warm. Temperatures today in Chicago hit a high of 65 after a low of 57. We've had about two-thirds of an inch of rain, and the lake is 62. Tonight's official readings in the city are at 65 O'Hare, 68 Midway, 68 at the lakefront, humidity 93%, wind southeast at 8, barometer 29.71. Clearing, cooler and less humid after scattered gusty thunderstorms in the next several hours, down to 48 by morning with winds switching southwest. Tomorrow, nice, sunny, breezy, less humid, a high of 68, southwest winds 10 to 20. Clouds come back tomorrow night, then breezy and cooler, a low of 42, a little rain coming in late. And cloudy, much cooler. Monday, a high of 56, and maybe a little bit of rain at that time. And for Tuesday, cloudy and cool, some sprinkles, and finally some sunshine by Wednesday, Bob. Autumn is here.
I was going to say, it sounds like good harvest weather.
Yeah, it really is. We'll have to dry the fields out a little bit after all that rain last night, but we'll do that tomorrow.
Okay, Tom, thanks very much. Coming up next on the 9 o'clock news, a look at the prequel to the Amityville Horror.
When Europeans get together with friends, they serve their wine in a carafe. Thanks to Paul Masson, we can enjoy this same tradition. Paul Masson's attractive carafe, an easy way to enjoy our great wines, like cool, delicious Paul Masson Chablis, rich, mellow Burgundy, or delightful rosé. The Paul Masson Carafe. The time has come for this great way to serve a great wine.
Order your new garage from Steel & Lober by October 31st and save up to 25%. Call now. Steel & Lober includes pre-finished fascia, soffit, and siding, plus a protector steel door with deadbolt lock for added safety, all without additional cost. You save when Steel & Lober replaces your overhead door with a stylish new pre-finished steel door. Call 641-2222 for your free garage or overhead door estimate. Steel & Lober, 641-2222.
Why do 100,000-mile flyers choose United?
You know, in this town, I never have a problem getting the best seat in the house, particularly when it's my show. Well, when I travel, I'm like anyone else, but I can still get the seat I want.
Anyone can, by reserving it in advance on United.
Seat 6B, Mr. Pat.
Reserve your seat when you reserve your flight. United will hold it up to 15 minutes before takeoff.
Row 6 on the aisle. Bravo, United.
People who fly for a living fly United's friendly skies.
Hi, Mike Ditka. The protector system does more than rust-proof your new car. Get the total protection system from the protector.
The film Amityville 2, The Possession, is now playing in Chicago area theaters. It's the subject of this week's CinemaScore, and here is Roy Leonard.
This week's CinemaScore report should help you avoid another clinker. Oh, the opening night audience was not at all impressed with Amityville 2, The Possession. This is the story that's supposed to explain why that famous house out on Long Island was the scene of those reported supernatural happenings a few years ago. Trouble starts when a new family moves into the old house. It's not a happy family. The father's a brute. The kids never know what to expect. The mother's a nervous wreck who realizes that things aren't quite right, and she asks the local priest to bless the house.
Oh, my bed too.
Well, after the blessing, things really start to cook. The eldest son becomes possessed. He kills the entire family. Now, the priest knows that he's under the influence of a supernatural power, but he can't prove it. But the makeup man and the sound technicians have a field day, just trying to scare the wits out of us. But it doesn't work. Nothing works in this movie. The characters aren't real, the situations aren't logical, and the so-called possession has no rhyme nor reason. And you don't have to be a critic to come to that conclusion. Here's how the opening night audience reacted. The under 25 age group could only give the movie a C+. The older crowd, a C-. Now, the 67% who came to see a horror film came up with a C+, while the 31% who just came along with the others only gave it a C. So, the overall rating for Amityville 2, The Possession, a C. And you've only got a 53% chance of liking it if the film attracts your interest. Now, if you want to see one of the new movies this weekend, according to CinemaScore, your best bet is Tempest, with Susan Sarandon and John Cassavetes in that modern version of the story loosely based on Shakespeare's theme, and you can forget all about Inchon and Amityville. I'm Roy Leonard.
Tomorrow, Chicago's Polish community will join others worldwide in a series of protests against the destruction of human rights in Poland. And that's our local report. Now for the details on an attack on Rome's main synagogue and the rest of the world news, we go to New York for this report from our independent network news team. Good night.